use this musical presentation as a preamble to the devotional, just to set a tone. Presiding over this musical presentation is Elder Larry S. Kacher, the first counselor in the Africa West Area Presidency. And my name is Regina Jigodi Prempeh, and I am conducting. We will start this program by inviting President Boateng, Alexander Boateng of Ashama, Ghana State, to give us the invocation. Thank you.
Our dear Father in heaven, in the name of thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ, we are grateful for this opportunity we have gathered here as thy children. We are here to share the messages of peace and love. We pray that thou bless all the presenters, the choristers, the instruments they will use, and all who are listening and watching from different parts of the world, that at the end will be edified and protected and glorify thy name as King and thy beloved Son as our Savior. We pray for these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much, President Boateng. We have two choirs here who are going to give us a presentation. We have the Adenta State Choir, and also we have the Ashaman Bethlehem and Ashaman and Bethlehem combined YSA Choir. They are in attendance, and they are going to treat us to some music and spoken word. And so I'll be calling them to do their presentation to us. They will be giving us a variety of songs, and also they will come out with some narration to the songs they'll be singing. So as the we'll first of all call on Adenta State to give us a scripture reading and also a song. Come unto him. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, good afternoon. In anticipation to our hearing the song from Adenta State, I'm privileged to speak to us on these write-ups. Sometimes we feel like pilgrims on a sea of strife. A pilgrim is one who has journeyed far from home, and that journey can leave us feeling wounded. But a pilgrim isn't a lost or aimless wanderer. As pilgrims, we journey with a purpose. We know that this unsettled world, with its trials and pain and disappointment, is not our true home. So we set off in search for heaven's strength and grace. When all else falls around us, we search in faith for something secure to hold on to. Someone we can rely on, someone we can never, who can never let us down. Where do we find it? These words of Holy Scriptures guide us. Quote, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, and ye shall find rest unto thy soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden light, close quote. It might seem strange to offer a yoke to someone seeking from rest from life's labor. How does a yoke help us when we are heavy laden? A yoke is a wooden beam fitted to the shoulder of a beast of burden, such as an ox, and hitched to a load to be pulled. It is designed to maximize the ox's pulling strength. Interestingly, a yoke is most often used to harness two animals so they can pull the load as a team. Even if one ox is smaller than and weaker than the other, the yoke unifies their effort. In this way, the strong one can help carry the load without dragging the other ox along. The full potential of both oxen is harnessed. By invitation to join him in his yoke, the Lord is not promising to make our burdens disappear. Instead, he offers to carry them with us, to heal us in our headaches, to comfort us in our sorrows. None of us is as strong as would like to be. We need help from someone greater than us. When our journey makes us weary, he can help us find what we've been searching for. Rest in him. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Oh,
Brothers and sisters, you agree with me that this is a very wonderful curtain raiser. We'll continue by asking the Ashaman and combine Ashaman and Bethlehem YSA choir to give us a presentation. This program will end exactly at 2:45 to make way for the devotional itself. And so we should be mindful of the time for our presentation. Thank you very much, Sharon.
Called to serve, Doctrine and Covenants, Section 4. Now behold, a marvelous work is about to come forth among the children of men. Therefore, O ye that are back in the service of God, see that ye serve him with all your heart, mind and strength, that ye may stand blameless before God at the last day. Therefore, if ye have desire to serve God, ye are called to work. For behold, the field is white, already to harvest. And lo, he that trusted in his sickle with his might, the same layeth up in store, that he perisheth not, but bringeth salvation to his soul. And faith, hope, charity, and love, with an eye single to the glory of God, qualifying him for the work. Remember faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, brotherly kindness, godliness, charity, humility, diligence. Ask, and ye shall receive. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. Call to serve him, heavenly King of glory. Amen.
Picking up litter. Some time ago, a motorist driving along a stretch of highway was intrigued to see three elderly women with large plastic bags picking up trash along the roadside. The driver knew that the highway cleanup was often assigned to fill a community service requirement, usually for those who had debts to pay to society. He smiled as he tried to imagine what these women could possibly have done to deserve this duty. He saw them again the next day, and the next day, and the next. Finally, his curiosity got the best of him, and he pulled over, leaned out the window and said, "Excuse me, I've noticed you along this stretch of road for a week now, and I couldn't help wondering what you did to get stuck with this job." The women looked at each other and laughed as they realized for the first time how they must look to a passerby. One of them replied, "We didn't get assigned to this job. We chose it. We each live alone, but we go walking together every morning, and we noticed all this litter along the highway. So we figured that if every morning during our regular walk, we stopped long enough to take just one bag of garbage out of the world, maybe we could make a difference. All of us share the resources of this world, and all of us have a vested interest in preserving it for future generations. But not all of us stop long enough to do something about it. The world is a more beautiful place because three walking companions decided to pick up some litter every day. But there's another lesson from their good turn. We also share the spiritual and emotional atmosphere of this world. And there are many kinds of debris that litter that environment. Unkind words, hurtful actions, discouragement, heartache, and loneliness. Wouldn't it be a more beautiful place if each of us determined to dispose of this kind of litter, to take just one bag of garbage out of the world each day?" The combination of two songs, "Nay Speak No Ill" and "Truth Reflects Upon Our Senses," helps us remember why we believe in Christ. It reminds us that if we follow the examples of Jesus Christ, which includes speaking kind words often and caring for our fellow brethren by ministering unto them, we'll return back to him. The prophet Alma was counseling his son and said, "Therefore, my son, see that you are merciful unto your brethren. Deal justly, judge righteously, and do good continually. And if you do all these things, then shall you receive your reward. Yea, ye shall have mercy restored unto you again, and ye shall have justice restored unto you again, and ye shall have righteousness restored unto you again, and ye shall have good rewarded unto you again." The kind deeds we do, the service we render, no matter how small, add to the growing circle of goodness. We can't clean it all at once, but if we each take our share of garbage out of the world, we can make it a more beautiful place for everyone.
Oh, now that's all seen is all. I would be pure and holy, I must love without a cry.
Brothers and sisters, I'm sure we are enjoying ourselves. We'll call on a shaman. I don't know, I keep missing the name. The YSA choir from a shaman in Bethlehem Sticks. I think that's a better way of calling it, so that makes life easy for me. So we'll call upon them, but because we don't have much time, we would ask that we take out the long narrations and then just do the music presentation. And so a shaman stick will present, let us all press on, and Adenta will come in with Ibike. Thank you.
So press on in the world.
Brothers and sisters, that was a special presentation to our brothers and sisters in Nigeria. Ibike, I don't really understand, but by my own revelation, I'll say today is a great day. That's what it means. You can ask them when the program is over. Thank you very much. All too soon, we are getting to the end of this musical presentation. We will ask a shaman, why essays of a shaman and Bethlehem stakes, to give us another presentation, after which we'll ask Adenta to do the final presentation, and we'll call on President Papadazi to give us the closing prayer. Thank you all for coming.
This is what we humbly ask of thee, In the holy name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters, Elder Kacher would like me to inform you that we should be getting ready for the devotional. It starts in the next 7 minutes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, we welcome you most warmly to this special devotion of the Accra West area. We gratefully acknowledge members and friends participating in Ghana, Liberia, Ivory Coast, Sierra Leone, Guinea, Mali, Senegal, Burkina Faso, Togo, Benin, and Nigeria. Presiding at this devotion is Elder Larry S. Kacher, First Counselor in Africa West Area Presidency. Also attending this meeting in various locations are Area 70s and State Presidents in Accra and Accra West. Elder Kacher has asked me, President Egan, to conduct this meeting. We'll begin this meeting by singing hymn number 240, Call to Serve, after which we'll be glad for Sister Uche Basi from Nigeria Port Harcourt Mission to give us an invocation. Please kindly unmute before you begin to speak.
Our dear Heavenly Father, Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we are grateful unto thee for this opportunity we have together worldwide to listen to Elder Sister Kacha in this devotional. We thank thee for the missionaries. We thank thee for the opportunity we have to light the world and preach the gospel. We thank thee for the restored gospel that we are blessed to have. We are grateful unto thee for Elder and Sister Kacha. God bless them.
We apologize for the technical failure. I'm sure it will work out. We shall now be glad to hear from President Isaac Morrison, Mission President of Ghana Cape Coast Mission. After he has addressed us, we will hear from Brother Christopher Udok from Nigeria Calabar State. He will be followed by Sister Na Setre from Tema, Ghana State. And she will be followed by Sister Victoria Nagi from Grand Bassam State. After which we will hear a special musical number performance.
Brothers and sisters, good afternoon to you all. I hope I can be heard by all of you who are connected today. Just for emphasis, if you can hear me, can you please wave? Awesome. Thank you very much. This is a beautiful opportunity for us to meet. And I'm grateful for the Kacher and the presidency for organizing such a beautiful time for us to sit down and reflect. I have been assigned to talk about why I believe in Jesus Christ. My goodness, how I love such a beautiful assignment. Dear brothers and sisters, this afternoon, I would like to share with you a couple of things that makes my belief in the Savior Jesus Christ so solid and so powerful. The first of the things that I would like to share with you, I have grouped it into four different stages. The first one is that I believe in the Savior Jesus Christ because the scriptures testify of the Savior. Brothers and sisters, fellow missionaries, our Father in heaven created us. He understood that we will face difficult challenges in life. So he provided us with tools to be successful. One of those tools that he gave us is the scriptures. Pondering a scripture can be a key to unlock revelation and the guidance of the Holy Ghost. The scriptures enlarge our memory by helping us to always remember the Lord and our relationship with him and the Father. The scriptures remind us of what we knew in our premortal life. In the scripture, we find firsthand experience of the blessings that come from honoring true principles. We read several scriptural accounts from the scriptures that strengthens our own faith and the faith of others. My dear brothers and sisters, we read this beautiful account in the Book of Mormon of the Savior's love for us and for him to atone for our sins. That is one of the great pillars I have that makes me to believe in Jesus Christ. Nephi said that because of his loving kindness and long suffering towards the children of men. I believe in the Savior because he first loved me. Two, is that I have opportunity to listen to a living prophet. Aren't we blessed to have living prophets in our day who are inspired to speak unto us from the Lord? Just as we hear in the scriptures from Moses, from Peter, Isaiah, and Nephi, and the rest. The Lord has declared, whether by my own voice or by the voice of my servant, it is the same. I love and believe in the Savior Jesus Christ because I feel that our greatest safety lies in strictly following the word of the living prophets. We are reminded again of the beautiful introduction that President Nelson gave us in the last general conference. He invited us that we look for pure truths, pure doctrine, and pure revelation. Sisters and brothers, ever since that conference, my attitude and my participation in sacrament meetings and other meetings has been to look for the pure truths and the doctrine and the inspiration that I will receive. That makes me to believe in the Savior Jesus Christ. Pillar number three is that I have opportunity to pray. Heavenly Father has not abandoned us. We are all his children. We are brothers and sisters. And because he loves us, he knows our needs. But he wants us to communicate with him. And we do so through prayer. As we make the habit of approaching God in prayer, we will come to know him and draw nearer to him. He has said, "Draw near unto me, and I will draw near unto you." Isn't that a beautiful thing of his love for us? As our desires become more like his, he will be able to bless us and not only us, our families. Now, Heavenly Father is ready to bless us. He's ready to give us the blessings if we but ask in faith. Brothers and sisters, I am always reminded of the beautiful account in Enos when he said, "For my soul hungered, and I kneeled down before my maker, and I cried unto him in mighty prayer and supplication for my own soul." This is a beautiful opportunity and one of the strong pillars of why I believe in Jesus Christ. Pillar number four is the restored gospel. Brothers and sisters, we are all gathered together here in the name of the Lord because of the restored gospel. The gospel is a gospel of peace, a gospel that blesses individuals and families. The gospel helps husbands to become better husbands, wives to become better wives, parents to become better parents, and children to become much more obedient and willing to strive for stronger relationship and spiritual strength in their families. You know, as I do, that the home is the best place for us to teach, to learn, and to apply these principles of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because his infinite love is sufficient for all of us. I am blessed with the program, the curriculum that we use, the Come Follow Me, that helps bless our own families as we strengthen our faith in studying and sharing what we have studied with each other. Dear brothers and sisters, let me take a couple of minutes and see how you can apply these beliefs that makes my belief in Jesus Christ so strong into the life of my own and that of others. Let me start with the scriptures. Through a miraculous means, I was able to get in touch with my dear friend that I have not seen for 20 years. He is a returned missionary, but ever since he returned from his mission, he has not been coming to church. He's married with 4 children. When I got wind of where he is, I traveled to go see him with my wife. When we went to him, we loved him. We embraced him. We opened the scriptures to read to him. He knew the scriptures. Now, this my good friend was so excited. I invited him to come back to church. He said he will come. Now, Augustine came to church with 4 of his children. And soon after, he was able to baptize 2 of those children. Now, Augustine was called to be a member of the Inketiakrum Ward Bishopric. It was through the power of scripture reading with this dear friend that I have not seen for many years. How happy I am for him and for his family and for his devotion and service in the Church of Jesus Christ. I believe in Jesus Christ because the scriptures testify of him. 2, in the April General Conference, we watched the conference on television. A dear friend by name Mary watched the conference on GH1 TV. She was not a member of the church. After watching the conference, she felt so loved, felt the spirit, and looked for the church in his and her locality. She found the church, and then she met 2 young missionaries who taught her and baptized her. Sister Mary is a beneficiary of the words of the living prophet. Why don't I believe in Jesus Christ? I do, because of the power of the name. 3, it's a dear friend, his name is Clement. Clement was a student of the University of Cape Coast here, studying PhD. Clement said, I have been praying to find the right church. I've been praying to see if the Savior Jesus Christ really loves me. Clement one day met 2 sister missionaries. They shared with him the gospel and invited him to go and pray. He did. And in his prayer, Clement was beautifully answered and he was baptized. Clement is serving faithfully in his local ward. Finally, brothers and sisters, as you may know, my family and I have gone through some difficult situations, but we've been so much blessed because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Several years ago, we lost our dear son, Kenneth, who was just 1.5 years old. How we miss him and how we love him and how we know of a surety that through the restored gospel, we can see Kenneth again someday. Brothers and sisters, just like Moroni, when he was concluding, he said, I, Moroni, will not deny the Christ. I, Morrison, and my family will not also deny the Christ. As we close, I want you to consider the words of Ita in the Book of Mormon, which says, I recommend you to seek this Jesus, whom the prophets and apostles have written, that the grace of God the Father and also the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost, which bear record of them, may be and abide in you forever. My dear brothers and sisters, I testify that God lives, that Jesus Christ is his son, that his love for us is infinite, and that this is his church, that he is the head of this church. I testify that the Book of Mormon is true, and I do this in the hallowed name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
My beloved brothers and sisters of the Africa West area of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, I'm grateful for the privilege to respond to the invitation by members of our area presidency to share my thoughts and feelings with you on the Book of Mormon, a book that changed my life. Brothers and sisters, I want to share with you my testimony that I came in contact with the church at a critical time in my life. I was a PhD student in France studying for my doctorate in international relations. And because of the obligations of my program, I had to write my dissertation in the French language, which was a second language to me. And it was difficult. However, following my baptism and the exhortation of a visiting general authority to France, President, to the members of the church to read the Book of Mormon from beginning to end, I decided to take up that challenge and read the book from the beginning to the end with other members of my district in Bordeaux. I discovered after that that as I settled down to work on my dissertation, after spending some time to read from the Book of Mormon, the process of writing in French was made easy for me, and I could write several pages of French without errors. And I observed that this continued, and at the end, I produced a dissertation of 411 pages in near perfect French. This was a miracle to me, and I had to identify the source of this miracle. And I discovered that it was the power that came to me from reading the Book of Mormon before writing that enabled me to accomplish my work. And so ever since I finished my PhD program and returned to Nigeria with a doctorate in international relations and got employed as a lecturer, I have discovered that each time I had a difficult assignment, if I preceded that assignment by reading some chapters of the Book of Mormon, it was easy for me to accomplish that task. And I also have learned that by reading the Book of Mormon before delivering my lectures, my delivery was better than if I had spent all my time to study the lesson material. So I now have a firm testimony that the Book of Mormon really has the power to change our lives. That change affects every aspect of, has affected every aspect of my life. From when I was called as a branch president to when I served as a district president and when I served as state president, I have relied on the Book of Mormon to bring the power and spirit of God into my life and into the things I needed to do. And I asked myself two questions. Why did the Book of Mormon have such a powerful effect on my life? Or why did it change my life? And how did it change my life? First of all, the Book of Mormon changed my life by exposing me to the powerful ideas that are contained in it. For example, in the Book of Mormon, it is clear that all of us are sons and daughters of Heavenly Father who has a purpose in sending us to the earth, and that by following his plan of salvation, where the Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, is the central figure who atoned for our sins and paid the price for our transgressions, we can always succeed through the grace of God, as taught by the prophet Nephi, that after all we can do, it is by grace that we are saved. Secondly, I also have learned that by praying to our Father in heaven, and luckily in the Book of Mormon, we have the powerful witnesses of the power of prayer. Enos, Nephi, all the major prophets in the Book of Mormon communed with our Father in heaven through fervent prayer. And so in the Book of Mormon, we learn how to pray. And then the question as to why this book has had such a powerful transforming effect on my life. I believe that it is because the Book of Mormon contains, first of all, a testimony of the resurrected Savior himself, who appeared to the people of Nephi and taught them personally from 3 Nephi chapter 11 to 27. Secondly, I always marvel at the testimony borne by the prophet Nephi of the resurrected Savior, when he declared that we talk of Christ, we rejoice in Christ, we preach of Christ, we prophesy of Christ, and we write according to our prophecies, that our children may know to what source they may look for a remission of their sins. For those who have read that scripture often, we know that it kind of summarizes our duties as members of the Lord's church. I also enjoy the admonition of the prophet Moroni, the invitation to come unto Christ and be perfected in him. And so with Christ as our model, in the role model in the Book of Mormon, and the powerful testimony that he himself bore of his divinity, and also the testimonies borne by Nephi, Alma, Helaman, and Moroni of the resurrected Savior. I know that by reading and studying the Book of Mormon, we can actually draw from the power of the Savior that is contained in this book. I am grateful that the first day that my wife visited the church, she actually found an answer in the Book of Mormon to a problem she had had all her life in her former church. And I know that because of studying the Book of Mormon, in May this year, my elder brother, who is 84 years old, accepted to be baptized into the church. And many of my students and many of my colleagues in the faculty who have read the Book of Mormon have agreed to investigate the church and be baptized into the Lord's restored church. So I testify that the Book of Mormon has had a major effect on my life. And without this token of the restoration, I would not be the person that I am today. I'm grateful for this privilege to share this testimony with you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
My dear brothers and sisters, I am talking to you this afternoon about faith in Jesus Christ, the power to move personal mountains. Well, for me, difficult life circumstances made me pause, take a deep breath, and a closer look as I evaluated my position then. Well, I took a cue from the three Israelite youth, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in 1 Daniel, what faith they exhibited. And I made the choice that I would rather be a firm, unshakable practitioner of my faith, no matter what life brought. And that has worked for me. Song number 96 in the children's song book entitled Faith reads, "Faith is knowing the sun will rise, lighting each new day. Faith is knowing the Lord will hear my prayer each time I pray. Faith is like a little seed. If planted, it will grow. Faith is a swelling within my heart. When I do right, I know. Simple, isn't it? But deep. And so, well, if you simply know, that may amount to having faith. But I think that is faith without works, because you do know. Well, until you also look forward to the sun rising. So you know the sun is going to rise, but you have a firm belief and you look forward to the sun rising. And for me, that is where you know. And then the faith and the action that backs the faith up. Faith, we learn from Apostle Paul in Hebrews 11, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And a portion of the overview of the doctrinal study on faith in Jesus Christ reads, faith is a principle of action and power. Activity on our part. The extent of that activity and the power thereof depends on me, depends on you. What I am saying to you, my dear brother and sister, is that belief or faith, however you want, or hope, however you want to call it, depends on you as an individual and the actions you take. We learn that faith to lead, or faith that leads to salvation, must be centered on our Savior Jesus Christ. And behold, there were diverse ways that he did manifest things unto the children of men, which were good. And all things which are good cometh of Christ. And of those who were on earth before Christ, we do read, wherefore, by the ministering of angels and by every word which proceeded forth out of the mouth of God, men began to exercise faith in Christ, and thus by faith they did lay hold upon every good thing, and thus it was until the coming of Christ. And after that he came, men also were saved by faith in his name, and by faith they become the sons of God. And here is the catch, my dear brothers and sisters. Whatsoever thing ye shall ask of the Father in my name, which is good, in faith, believing that ye shall receive, behold, it shall be done unto you. And this is what the Savior, Jesus Christ himself, tells us. Our faith obviously must be centered on our dear Lord Jesus Christ. So, what are the struggles and the challenges and the mountains that we need moving out of our way, just so we can be happy or we can have the peace that we're looking for? Well, I think the time to take action is now. The time to increase, improve, and grow your faith is now. Our action of faith can bring on the power. Our faith can help us overcome anything. And our Lord Jesus Christ promises that if ye shall have faith in me, ye shall have power to do whatsoever thing expedient in me. And I take that point of whatsoever. It does not matter what, no matter how big. We have been told also that if we can think it, we can become. The practice of acting in faith will make us perfect in it. Let's take action in faith to overcome everything, and I mean anything and everything. Well, all our struggles, contentions, temptations, you name them. And as we do, we would be nurturing our faith to grow or to keep it growing bigger and stronger. We may sometimes fall, or we may sometimes fail to make the mark, but that's all right. But should you fall, remember to pick yourself up, dust yourself down, and start all over again. Because we have a gift of repentance that is so abundant and available to us. Brothers and sisters, I know the Lord lives, and he is keeping every single one of his promises. Let us qualify and make ourselves and our actions reaching out in faith for the blessings which are already in motion. Let us reach out and grab ours so that we can have the peace of mind and peace of heart and peace of being in this life and the next. And I say these things most humbly, knowing that we are in the right place. I have heard it said that we don't just go through the church, but we allow the church to also go through us. And we find all the teachings exactly where we have them in our scriptures. And I know that when we keep to these and the straight and narrow, it will be well with us. I share these humbly with you in the hallowed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Bonjour, chers frères, chers sœurs et chers dirigeants. L'apôtre Paul a déclaré « L'affliction de la chair, c'est la mort, tandis que l'affliction de l'esprit, c'est la vie et la paix. » Dans notre état déchu, nous devons souvent combattre la tentation et nous succombons parfois à volonté.
Paul declared, « The affliction of the flesh is death, while the affliction of the spirit is
la chair de la chair et au mal qui est en elle. Pour être capable de recevoir la bénédiction de la vie éternelle, nous devons avoir l'affection de l'esprit et vaincre nos désirs impurs. Nous devons changer. Plus exactement, nous devons être changés ou convertis par le pouvoir de l'expiation du Sauveur et par le pouvoir du Saint-Esprit. Ce processus s'appelle la conversion. La conversion est un changement total. Un changement de notre nature même. C'est un changement tellement important que le Seigneur et ses prophètes en parlant comme d'une renaissance, d'un changement de cœur et du baptême de feu. Le Seigneur a dit, n'éteint-on pas de ce que toute l'humanité, oui, les hommes, les femmes, toutes les nations, tribus, langues et peuples doivent naître de nouveau, et oui, naître de Dieu. Changer de leur état charnel et déchu à un état de justice, étant racheté par Dieu, devenant ses fils et ses filles. Et ainsi, ils deviennent de nouvelles créatures. Et s'ils ne font pas cela, ils ne peuvent en aucune façon hériter le royaume de Dieu. La conversion est un processus, non pas un événement. Notre conversion est le résultat de nos justes efforts pour suivre le Sauveur. La conversion étant un processus discret et constant. Il se peut que nous soyons convertis actuellement sans nous en rendre compte. Nos efforts continuels pour exercer notre foi et suivre le Sauveur produiront une plus grande conversion. Notre prophète bien-aimé Russell M. Nelson a dit, « La foi en Jésus-Christ est le plus grand pouvoir auquel nous ayons accès dans cette vie. » Tout est possible à ceux qui croient. Nous sommes le premier responsable de notre conversion. Personne ne peut être converti pour nous et personne ne peut nous forcer à nous convertir. Les personnes peuvent nous aider dans le processus de la conversion. David A. Bernard a dit, la conversion est un rapprochement, un approfondissement et un élargissement des fondements du témoignage. Elle est le résultat de révélation de Dieu, accompagnée du repentir, de l'obéissance et de la diligence. Si nous cherchons honnêtement la vérité, nous pouvons être convertis en connaissant un grand changement du cœur et en naissant spirituellement de Dieu. Voici les quatre caractéristiques des gens qui sont convertis. Ils désirent faire le bien. Ils ne se rebellent pas contre le Seigneur. Ils proclament l'Évangile et sont remplis d'amour. Le témoignage est le début et la condition préalable de la conversion continue. Le témoignage est le point de départ. Il n'est pas notre destination finale. Un témoignage fort est la fondation sur laquelle la conversion s'est construite. Je vais vous raconter mon processus de la conversion au Seigneur. Mon processus avait pris beaucoup de temps. Ma rencontre avec mon mari était en 2009 en Russie. Je me souviens bien, un jour, je viens chez lui et j'ai vu Léona. J'ai demandé qu'est-ce que c'est. Sa réponse était, c'est mon église. Il a dit le nom de l'église. Et ma deuxième question, ce n'est pas une secte. Mon mari a souri et a dit non. Et on a fini notre conversation comme ça. Après, le même jour, j'ai commencé à chercher le site de l'église. Comme je suis tellement curieuse, j'ai regardé tout. C'est comme ça que j'ai fini ma recherche. Après notre mariage, nous avons parlé beaucoup de l'Évangile. J'ai vu que mon mari a eu une grande foi en Jésus-Christ. Même quand il faisait tellement froid, moins 30 degrés, mon mari allait à l'église. Il m'a toujours dit, je vais renouveler mes alliances avec Dieu. Mon mari ne m'a pas forcé et jamais à le suivre. Il savait que Dieu allait faire son travail. J'ai rencontré beaucoup de missionnaires. Ma première rencontre avec le missionnaire était Pascal. Dans notre ville, il n'y avait pas de missionnaires, même ni paroisse ou branche, mais un groupe organisé. L'œuvre de Dieu est formidable. Au fur et à mesure, les gens ont commencé à se baptiser et on a eu notre première branche dans ma vie. Les missionnaires sont apparus. Je me souviens des noms des missionnaires avec qui j'avais discuté beaucoup de l'Évangile. Cameron Krause, Brett Miller, Derek White, ils ont fait un bon travail, mais moi, je n'avais pas eu mon propre témoignage. Même j'ai lu le livre des moments. J'ai assisté à la Sainte-Seine. Mon processus à la conversion a continué. Ça a pris 7 ans. En tout cas, mon mari était tellement patient. Nous avons décidé à venir nous installer en Côte d'Ivoire en novembre 2015. J'ai continué à aller à l'église. Les missionnaires m'ont aidé encore avec l'Évangile. Même j'ai reçu un appel de l'Utah. C'était les missionnaires russes là-bas. Et Derek White, ex-missionnaire, a rencontré cette missionnaire au temple à Utah. Et comment s'est passé? Derek a appelé mon mari et a demandé est-ce que les missionnaires pouvaient m'appeler. Ils ont appelé pour rendre le témoignage de l'Évangile rétabli du Seigneur Jésus-Christ. C'était incroyable. Dieu est puissant. J'ai eu mon témoignage à l'église. Un dimanche, à la deuxième heure, nous avons assisté à un enseignement. Donc, le thème était baptême. Et dirigé par un bon instructeur, frère Fidel Quadio. Pendant l'enseignement, j'ai entendu une voix interne comme si quelqu'un me parlait. J'avais bien senti ça par l'esprit que je devais me faire baptiser maintenant. J'avais eu mon témoignage sur l'Évangile rétabli. Après ce moment formidable, je n'avais pas dit à mon mari. Je voulais lui faire une surprise. Mon mari était au travail, je l'avais appelé pour dire que je voulais me baptiser et que c'était lui qui devrait le faire. Il était étonné, mais il n'avait pas de mots. Il était très, très content. Le 21 mai 2016, ma nouvelle vie a commencé par mon baptême. J'étais convertie au Seigneur. Pendant mon processus de ma conversion, j'ai passé par ces 4 étapes. La connaissance, l'œuvre missionnaire, le témoignage, le baptême. Grâce à ces étapes et à l'expiation de Jésus-Christ, ma vie a changé positivement. Ces étapes n'étaient que le début de la semence de la parole dans mon cœur, ce qui a éclairé mon esprit et m'a amené dans les eaux du baptême. Mais ce n'était pas la fin. Il me fallait faire grandir mon témoignage et ma foi en Jésus-Christ et en l'Évangile rétabli. Donc, j'ai commencé à prier. Fait un festin de la parole de Dieu, le livre des moments, les doctrines et alliances, l'histoire de l'Église, les paroles de nos dirigeants, etc. Aller à l'Église chaque dimanche, magnifier mon appel de l'instructrice à la primaire. À ce niveau, cet appel m'éclaire de plus en plus sur la doctrine du Christ aux petits-enfants. Je les aime beaucoup. Grâce à l'aide de mon évêque et de mes amis frères de l'Église et mon mari, je suis arrivée à un élément très, très important pour moi. pour ma conversion, qui est mon scellement au temps. Je sais que l'Église est vraie, le livre de Mormon est la parole de Dieu. Cette Église est dirigée par Jésus-Christ. Et je sais que Jérusalem Nelson est réellement le prophète de Dieu. Au nom de Jésus-Christ, Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Prayer. Especially the combined choir of Penta and Ashiama State Choir. At this time, it will be our privilege to hear from Elder and Sister Kacher. They'll be speaking together. After they've addressed us, we will sing as our closing hymn, Joseph Smith's First Prayer. And the benediction will be given by Sister Priscilla Danso from the Medina Stick. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for attending. Elder and Sister Kacher.
Brothers and sisters, what a privilege it is for us to be here with you tonight. To begin, we'd like to express our gratitude for those who have spoken thus far, for their powerful messages and their testimonies of Jesus Christ. That is our theme tonight. Why we believe in Jesus Christ. We're so grateful for these two choirs as well who have prepared so diligently and have sung so beautifully. And we know this is a complex technological task. This being broadcast to so many different countries in so many different locations. It's been amazing to me how well it's gone. We want to express our love to you. We know that God lives and that Jesus is the Christ.
So I'll just take a few minutes to introduce us to you. We have quite different backgrounds from each other. I grew up in a small farm in a tiny town, only about 150 people in my town, in a little valley in the mountains in Utah. My husband, on the other hand, grew up in what I consider the city. It was actually the suburbs, but he grew up in Minnesota. I grew up in a family that had been in the church for five generations. All of my ancestors have been members of the church since pretty much the beginnings of the church. My husband, on the other hand, was baptized when he was 19 years old, and he's the only member in his entire family. So we come from very different backgrounds, but we feel that is a great strength as we come together as husband and wife and parents to our children. We have raised our children in Minnesota. We also lived in Belgium in that time, and we also had the opportunity to serve as mission president and wife in the Switzerland Geneva mission. That was 20 years ago. Then we also had the opportunity to live in the Middle East in Abu Dhabi, where my husband was the Area 70 over the Middle East, North Africa, which was a wonderful experience. Then he was called to be a general authority, and we were assigned to be in the president. He was assigned to be in the presidency in East Europe. So we lived in Moscow, Russia. That was a wonderful opportunity too. And then we had the great opportunity to come here to Africa, and he is serving here in the area presidency, and we love living here, and we love all of you good people that we've gotten to know here. Oh, we have six children and soon to be 23 grandchildren.
You know, I look old, but she still looks young. You're probably wondering why she looks so young and I look so old. Brothers and sisters, tonight we'd like to structure this just a little bit differently. We look at you truly as brothers and sisters. So this is going to be kind of a casual conversation. We've invited you into our homes, maybe for a family home evening. The younger ones of you will call our sons and daughters and your friends that you have brought along with you. We would just like you to feel at home, feel in our home for a few minutes as we talk back and forth just a little bit. Now, in preparation for this, we thought about some of the questions we've heard over the time that we've spent here in other parts of the world. So part of what we discuss with you will be in the form of posing these questions to each other and taking turns answering those questions. But they're all based on the principle of why we believe in Jesus Christ. Sister Kacher, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Good, because I was going to anyway. Sister Kacher, you know, one of the things that we hear no matter where we go is why so many difficult things happen to people, even very good people who live very good lives. What are your thoughts on that?
It's true. When we travel to different missions, we ask missionaries what kinds of things people ask them as they're teaching them. Every time, one of the responses is always, why do bad things happen to good people? It's a universal question and a question that has an answer. Let's start out with the main thing to know, and that is that God does love us. No matter what we're experiencing in life, we can have absolute knowledge that our Heavenly Father loves us. Elder Holland, who is a member of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles, has said that we know that the first great commandment is to love God with all our heart, might, mind, and strength. That's the first great commandment. But he taught us that the first great and eternal truth is that God loves us with all his heart, might, mind, and strength. That's love beyond what we can imagine, isn't it? And he has it for us. But he also loves us so much that he allows us all to have our agency here on earth. He would not ever take that away from us. And because we all have agency, things happen here on earth. They just happen. But I want to share with you, we read in the scriptures about the refiner's fire. That refers to when you put a metal like silver or gold into fire, and it gets it so hot that it melts and all the bad things float to the top and they can skim them away. Sometimes we find ourselves in the refiner's fire of life when things get so difficult. And sometimes when people are in those problems, they turn away from Heavenly Father and lose faith. But we know that as we turn to Heavenly Father, when we're in the refiner's fire, that we will come out stronger and brighter. I will share with you a story that's a very personal story. President Morrison shared a similar story. This is about my sister. When she and her husband were young, they had a 3-year-old and a 1.5-year-old. They were finishing school, and it was an exciting day that they were moving out of their student apartment and into a home. It was an exciting day, and people had come out to help. And in the process of the move, their little 3-year-old gave loose of the hand of the person she was holding onto and ran right into the moving truck and was killed. It was a terrible tragedy, but the thing that made the tragedy worse is that her father was the one driving the truck. Now you can see that this was the time that they could easily turn away from Heavenly Father and say, why did you let this happen? They could turn away from each other and say, why did you let this happen? They could have taken that path, but they didn't. They chose to turn their hearts toward Heavenly Father and to his atonement. They turned their hearts to the knowledge that they were sealed in the temple forever and that they would see their little Jenny again and be able to raise her after the resurrection. And over the years, it's been 45 years now, and over the years, they've grown stronger, deeper in love with each other, and closer to our Heavenly Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. They surely entered the refiner's fire, brighter and stronger. He understands, Jesus understands every pain that we experience, because when he atoned for our sins, he experienced those pains himself, and he's the one person that can say, I know how you feel, and he will bless us. I will just read one thing that was said in conference a few years ago by Sister Reeves. She said, I do not know why we have the many trials that we have, but it's my personal feeling that the reward is so great, so eternal and everlasting, so joyful and beyond our understanding, that in that day of reward, we may feel to say to our merciful, loving Father, was that all that was required? I believe that if we could daily remember and recognize the depth of that love our Heavenly Father and our Savior have for us, we would be willing to do anything to get back in their presence again, surrounded by their love eternally. What will it matter what we suffered here if in the end those trials are the very things which qualify us for eternal life and exaltation in the kingdom of God with our Father and Savior? So, Elder Kacher, what would you teach us about the plan of salvation?
Well, you just taught it so well, Sister Kacher. I remember that day vividly. In fact, it was my birthday in 1977. I had just turned, I can't remember how old I was. It doesn't matter. The phone rang. I heard your mother scream. And then we found out about Jenny's death. How could this have happened, brothers and sisters? What was the perspective that Doug and Carolyn, Pauline's sister and her husband, had in order to overcome this tragedy and to be able to keep it in its eternal context? If I could, for a minute, let me talk to the friends of the church who might be listening in today. Heavenly Father loves us so much that he gave us an opportunity to grow and to be tested in this life. Our existence did not begin here, as we learn from the scriptures. It had a place elsewhere. In fact, we are the spirit children of a loving Heavenly Father and Heavenly Mother. They love us so much that they give us the opportunity to come to earth. Sister Kacher mentioned the principle of agency, of free agency. As you study the book of Revelations, you see that when different plans were presented to Jesus Christ and to Heavenly Father, for how we could progress in the life before this one, those two plans were different. One was authored by the adversary, and a third of the hosts of heaven followed him. They rejected the plan of our Heavenly Father. Two-thirds of us, you and me included, we made the decision through our agency, even though we knew it would not be easy to come to earth. Two specific reasons, at least, why we came here. One was, as Sister Kacher said, was to be tested, to see if we would remain faithful. Perhaps, first of all, to see if we would seek for the truth, if we would try to find what God wanted us to do. You see, in each side, each one of us is a light, a special light. And if we nurture that light, it will lead us to truth. It will lead us towards our Heavenly Father, and we will feel his love. We choose every day, brothers and sisters, whether we will follow that light. It is called the light of Christ, referred to in the Book of Mormon. As we follow that light, our eyes will be open. We will be able to understand that the challenges that we experience in this life are truly opportunities to grow. Our decisions are so important for each one of us. As President Monson said, our decisions will determine our destiny. Now, the second reason was to gain a physical body. Before I was baptized into this church, I was taught that God was just a spirit, that the concept of us being created in his image was not really accurate, that it was theoretical. But we have come to find out that we truly are created in the image of God. We are not just spirits in this life, but we have a physical body. And that was the second reason why we came to earth. It was to gain this body. Now, brothers and sisters, some of us have perfect bodies, like my dear wife. Some of us struggle in different ways. Some of us may even come into this life a little bit handicapped, or even with major handicaps. I think of the little girl President Boateng and I visited last week, who was born into this life with a disease that has crippled her. She can't move. She can't move her body. And her mother or father have to carry her around. Is that fair, brothers and sisters? Is that fair? Well, we come to understand in the gospel of Jesus Christ that our existence here on earth is very short. And that after this life, because of the atonement of Jesus Christ, because he has broken the bands of death, because he has suffered the pains of our sins and our afflictions, that he has paved the way for our resurrected bodies to be perfect, to be whole, to never be handicapped again. So as we come to this life, brothers and sisters, we must do so with our eyes open, with our hearts open, seeking to understand what God would have us do, where he would have us go. We are here as disciples of Jesus Christ to proclaim that God has restored his church on the earth, and in that plan contains the fullness of the gospel, including the plan of salvation. It gives us reason and understanding to be able to endure life's challenges, not unlike Job, who suffered so many things, but still remained faithful. Because of the atonement of Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters, we will have an opportunity again one day to live together as Carolyn and Doug with their beloved Jenny for time and for all eternity. Because of Jesus Christ, we will have the opportunity to repent of our sins, to be cleansed, to be made whole, to stand before him one day to be judged for our achievements, our challenges, even our sins that we've committed in this life. And all will be made right because God is a just God. Now, there are many in this life who have not had the opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. What of them? Members of the church know that because Jesus Christ is fair and loving, because we are children of a heavenly Father who cares about us, as part of his eternal plan, those who have left this mortal existence without the opportunity to hear the fullness of the gospel will have that opportunity. In fact, the Savior, after his crucifixion, left this life and went to the world of spirits and proclaimed the gospel to those missionaries who would preach, to those in spirit prison who had not yet had that opportunity. That is how fair and just God is. But what about the ordinances that they have not had the opportunity to receive, such as baptism? How could Jesus Christ say, unless a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God, and then not provide an opportunity for that to happen? Well, he has, brothers and sisters. We testify that he has. Next to me, next to us is a temple, a holy edifice of the Lord Jesus Christ, where his ordinances are performed for those who have not had that opportunity in this life. So, Sister Kacher, how grateful I am for that plan of salvation, for how much it means to me. That is why Doug and Carolyn can go forth in this life, knowing one day that they'll have that opportunity to be with their beloved Jenny again. Well, let's see. Sorry, my computer closed. You know, you mentioned that we have 6 children and 23 grandchildren. How is your understanding of the gospel? How has it helped you to be such a wonderful mother?
That wasn't exactly the question. The question was how has that helped us raise our children in this world? It is a difficult world, isn't it? It's a difficult world. And when we talked about this question, the first word that came to my mind was clarity. Clarity. Why did that word come to my mind? It's because as we raised our children in the gospel of Jesus Christ, there was never a question of what principles we should be teaching them, what standards that we should ask of them and expect of them, how much love we should give them, what tools we had to teach these things. All those things were very clear because of our membership in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. We are given the tools and information and all that we need as we raise our children. We knew that as we turned our hearts and our children toward Jesus Christ and had a Christ-centered home, that we would still have problems, but within those problems, we knew that life would be easier by following the principles of the gospel of Jesus Christ than it would otherwise be. Not problem-free, but easier. We would still carry burdens, but our burdens would be lightened. And that was certainly true. The prophet, President Nelson, has told us that in the coming days, it will not be possible to survive spiritually without the constant guidance of the Holy Ghost. That's a pretty powerful statement from a prophet. Now, he wouldn't give us that statement without a way, would he? How do we have the constant guidance of the Holy Ghost in our lives and in our families? The answer is really simple. Family prayer, family scripture study, attending church together as a family every week, serving and loving each other, paying our tithes,
doing as Jesus Christ would have us do, and is the example that he set for us. And in that way, we can have the Spirit in our home at all times. We know this to be true because we've seen it in our own children. Joseph Smith once said about the people in the churches that we teach them correct principles and they govern themselves. And we found that in our family also. We taught them correct principles and knew that they would make good choices. And when we sent our children off to college and away from home, some of them at a very young age, we did so with confidence that they would stay true to the standards and principles that they had been taught as they were growing up, because those principles had sunk deep in their hearts and it was their own beliefs. And it was a great blessing. What would you say as a father?
I guess the first thing I'd say is how lucky I am to have married you.
I'm the lucky one.
President Nelson has said, we can't control the circumstances in our lives, but we can control our focus. We can't control our focus. We can't control our thoughts, even when bad things happen around us. Now, as Sister Kacher said earlier, I'm a convert to the church. I had good parents, wonderful parents, but they did not have the blessings of the gospel to teach their children. Well, unfortunately for me, and I'll share this with you if you promise not to tell anybody else, I couldn't get along with my father. He and I struggled in our relationship when I became a teenager. And so when I was about 17 years old, he got pretty upset with me for what I thought was something that was not really justified. Has that ever happened to any of you before? All of you, as you understand. Well, I was a little bit headstrong. And he looked at me and he laid down the law. And he said, if you don't like it, get out. Well, I went downstairs where my bedroom was. I grabbed a suitcase. He followed me down the stairs. And he said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm getting out. Well, brothers and sisters, that period of time for me was an important time. That independence is what I needed in my life to be able to be led to the gospel of Jesus Christ. That period of my time was so important to me because through that time, when I was taught by the missionaries, which I'll talk about in a minute, I learned how important my father was and how important my mother was. I realized that in many ways it wasn't them, but it was me being headstrong. I gained a perspective and an understanding of eternal families. So, Sister Kacher, you asked me, how did that help me with our children? I remember one time when one of our four boys, what it was, it wasn't too serious. Anger began to well up inside of me. I thought, I'm really going to let him have it. And then I remembered this experience with my father. And I thought of what he had said to me and the impact that it had. When egos clash between a father and son, the outcome is not always pretty. So I decided to change. What allowed me to change, brothers and sisters, was my understanding of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I was able to put things in perspective. And when my son came home from doing something kind of dumb, I said, well, Ryan, I've got a free Saturday. How about we go do some fun things together? That Saturday became one of the most funnest days of my life with my son. I'm sure he was expecting to be punished for what he had done. But because of the gospel, because of my understanding, newfound understanding of the plan of salvation, I was able to react differently. You see, brothers and sisters, God does not see us as we are. He sees us as who we have the potential to become. I invite each one of us to consider that in our homes and in our families, to see each other, especially our children, as they have the potential to become. You see, when Christ commanded us to be therefore perfect, even as our Father in heaven is perfect, He was serious. He meant it. Because they see us as who we have the potential to become.
So this is another question for you. So it sounds like, and I know that his youth wasn't real religious, church-oriented growing up years. And so it's a question, how did you find the gospel? How did you make such a change in your life?
Well, let me just take a minute and talk about that. I remember, brothers and sisters, it was because of people like you. That's why we asked you to bring your friends here tonight. We hope there are many friends of the church around West Africa who are listening. We hope you have felt something by the wonderful messages and music that has been given thus far. You see, that's what changed my life. I saw examples from members like you, and I said, something is missing. There has to be something more. And so when I was taught by the missionaries, and over a period of time, even though I was raised in a different church, I noticed five characteristics of that church. Let me review with them briefly. Number one, the Church of Jesus Christ, when he lived on the earth, was founded upon a foundation of apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. The name of the church was the Church of Jesus Christ. That's a hallmark, brothers and sisters. That's a starting point to know if the church has been restored on the earth again. Is it patterned after the Church of Jesus Christ when he lived on the earth? When I discovered that at the head of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is a living prophet and 12 apostles, I was touched. And when I understood that a prophet didn't replace Jesus Christ, he didn't run the church, but he was a mouthpiece for the Savior. And Jesus Christ himself leads his church. Number two, I wondered about priesthood authority. Often I would hear of people who went to divinity college and received a degree. And somehow that gave them priesthood authority to become a minister or a pastor. But in the scriptures, we are taught that the Savior laid his hands upon Peter's head. And he said, whatever is bound on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever is loosed on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Jesus Christ conferred upon Peter the keys of the kingdom. He had already conferred upon him the priesthood authority. And I began to understand a little bit more clearly the importance of that priesthood authority. You see, there are a couple of scriptures that were confusing to me in the Bible and the teachings of the outside world. Christ has taught that we must be baptized to enter the straight and narrow gate. Somehow that was interpreted in the outside world that if a baby was not baptized, that they were condemned to die. They were condemned to be left out of Heavenly Father's presence for all eternity. How did that square with the scripture when the disciple asked Jesus Christ, who shall be the greatest in the kingdom of God? And the Savior held up a little child and said, unless you be humble yourself and become as a little child, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God. When I was taught, brothers and sisters, the true doctrine from the restored gospel, that little children don't sin. They don't need baptism. The original sin is what it's called from Adam and Eve. Isn't that placed on the heads of little babies? That price was paid for by the Lord Jesus Christ. Number three, it will contain all the saving ordinances of the gospel, baptism with authority. But the doctrine that I love the most, brothers and sisters, is the doctrine of eternal families in the Church of Jesus Christ. It's the doctrine that teaches that families are meant to be together forever. There is no more until death do you part. There is a marriage sealed for time and for all eternity for those who live according to God's commandments. Number four, it will be a missionary church. Before the Savior left, his parting words to the disciples were, "And Matthew, go preach the gospel to the entire world." And so they did. So it is today. Full-time missionaries, why don't you just stand up for just a minute? Let's see our full-time missionaries who are here with us today. Brothers and sisters, these are part of the army of Israel. Thank you very much. These are like the disciples of old. Over 60,000 missionaries have been called to proclaim the restored gospel of Jesus Christ at their own expense or at the expense of those who can help them. They go forward, not having gone to divinity school, just like the disciples of old who were fishermen or tax collectors or whatever occupations they might have been. They were called because they loved the Lord Jesus Christ and they wanted to serve him. We love the missionaries. They go forth in the name of Jesus Christ. They wear the name of Jesus Christ on their nameplates. You can recognize them that way. Dear friends of the church, please listen to these devoted disciples of Jesus Christ. And number five, a hallmark of the true church, as I learned as I investigated it, that Heavenly Father is fair. There are many who have left this mortal I know that it does. I know that it does. That is why the work of family history is so important to us. We identify our ancestors. We provide for them. We know that they will have the opportunity to be taught in the spirit world. But we also know that without us, the saving ordinances of the gospel, like baptism, confirmation, receiving the priesthood, being sealed in the temple for time and all eternity, cannot be done. So that work is performed in the holy temples of the Lord. 1 Corinthians, the question was asked, why were they baptized for the dead if the dead rise not at all? Why are they then baptized? Brothers and sisters, they do rise again, but their performances, their ordinances have to be performed. And we have the sacred opportunity to perform that. Now, as the missionaries taught me, I could feel my heart changing. I felt in my heart that the gospel was true. I had come to know my Savior, Jesus Christ, in a way that I had never known him before. I understood that God the Father and Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost were three separate and distinct beings, not one physically or spiritually. They were one in purpose. They were separate. And as I felt that, I had a desire to follow the example of Jesus Christ and to be baptized. But I had a concern. Would I be strong enough to keep the commandments? So before I said yes to the missionaries, I returned to my home. I wanted to hang out with my old friends to see if I'd be tempted to do those things that I used to do. And what I found was there was no temptation. There was no temptation. There was no comparison of what I had discovered and what I had found. I went back and was baptized, and I have never, ever looked back. Sister Kacher, I think you're the fifth generation member of the church, as you said. How has that blessed your life?
Well, I'm grateful that he decided to be baptized. It's blessed our lives. So yes, as he said, I grew up in a home that was pretty well entrenched in the gospel. Our ancestors had been members since the beginning of the church, pretty much. And it was a great blessing to live in a home that there is no question about what our values or morals or standards should be. We knew who we were. We knew what was expected of us. We knew what God expected of us. And we lived that way. It blessed our lives. It was a firm foundation that we were given, and I'm so grateful for that. The the scripture in Doctrine and Covenants 64 says, be not weary of well-doing, for you're building a firm, for you're building a foundation, and it is out of simple things that great things come to pass. The Lord asks for a heart and the willing mind. And that was what I felt like in the home that I grew up in, that we were truly building a firm foundation. None of us did anything great or spectacular. My parents were just good, solid members of the church, but it was by small, everyday things that built our firm foundation. And every one of my siblings have stayed close to the gospel of Jesus Christ because of that foundation. We had a happy home. As I said, we grew up on just a small farm. We all worked hard on the farm, learned hard work. And we didn't have, compared to the people around us, we did not have very much money. Nobody did, but we seemed to have even less. But we never went without. We had peace and happiness and harmony in our home. We paid our tithing and we always had what we needed. And we were greatly, greatly blessed. So when I think about the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, if someone were to say to me, do you think you'd ever leave? I'd have to answer as Peter did to Jesus. Jesus came to the point that his disciples decided it was too hard to follow him. And they, many of the Lord's disciples decided to, as it says, they went back and walked no more with him. And when that happened, Jesus turned to his 12 apostles and said, how about you? Are you going to walk away too? And Peter gave the answer that I would give also. He said, Lord, to whom shall we go? And that's my feeling also. I would say, Lord, to whom shall I go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and I believe, and I'm sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. So grateful for the foundation of the gospel of Jesus Christ that I received in the home that I grew up in. So, Elder Kacher, let's...
Wait a minute, I've got another question for you. Sister Kacher really did grow up in a wonderful home. Could you just take a minute and talk about the relationship between your mother and your father?
Sure, yeah. You know, my dad is a big, strong farmer, kind of a mountain man kind of a guy. And he was so gentle and meek and kind to my mother. I never, ever saw him get upset at my mother, ever. He would open the door for her. He would carry her purse for her. He mopped the floor for her between his farm chores. He did everything he hoped that she wanted him to do. And in turn, she also served him with all of her heart and soul. And they're really, truly, I never remember of a strong words between them. They were always loving and a wonderful example to us. And they always loved us. Oh, okay. So I have the next question. So let's talk about continuing revelation. We know that we can receive personal revelation, and we know that we also have a prophet and apostles that are messengers of our Heavenly Father. And we've been in a pretty difficult time in this world, haven't we? And it's been an incredible thing to see how our prophet has led us through these times. Elder Kacher, why don't you talk about that?
Well, I'll just take a minute and do that. Then I've got another question for you about the restoration. Now, first of all, going back to the time of Joseph Smith, the prophet of the restoration, when God called one more time a living prophet on the earth when a people had been prepared. Because of the life of Joseph Smith, the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ was restored. But the restoration is ongoing. It continues, and thus the need for a living prophet. In the book of Revelations, where it talks about words being added on to the end of that book, we'll ask Sister Kacher in a minute just exactly what that means, because God continues to speak to his prophets. A modern day example, all the members of the church know that before COVID, President Nelson taught us that we should be as we saw President Isaacson, President Morrison comment on, we should be home-centered. We should not be dependent upon the church. So as a result of that, two different programs were introduced, one for the children and the youth, and one for the entire family. One called the Children and Youth Program, a very simple program based on the scripture of Luke 2:52, which talks about how Jesus grew. He grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and with man. In other words, he grew intellectually, he grew physically, he grew spiritually, and he grew socially. A simple framework that our children now set goals to become more like the Savior. This morning, I had the blessing of listening to the young woman present a program of the Cantonets work. Wonderful to hear the goals that they have set and how these goals help them to become more like the Savior. The second program that the prophet introduced before COVID was, of course, Come Follow Me, an organized program for families to be able to study the gospel at home together. Families of all ages, to help our children learn more about Jesus Christ in this church, about how to live, navigate the challenges in this life. Shortly after, brothers and sisters, as we know, COVID came. Church was canceled, but members of the church were fully equipped to practice the gospel in the home. Brethren who hold the priesthood could administer the sacrament in the home. Children could set goals to become more like the Savior. Families could study the Word of God. I know that President Nelson is a modern day prophet today, in his 98th year now, still strong. He'll be here as long as the Lord wants to leave him here. A wonderful person, a wonderful example, who submits his will to the Savior. Now, Sister Kacher, in the Bible, we learn that the Lord had other sheep that he had directed to different parts of the world. We also know that they've been commanded to keep records. Help us understand a little bit about that.
About the Book of Mormon. So we've already heard a wonderful, wonderful testimony of the Book of Mormon this evening. I just want to take a step back and mention the prophet. I just want to testify of how grateful I am for a living prophet. And we talked a few minutes ago about having a strong home and strong family and how do we raise our children. I will tell you, follow the prophet. Follow the prophet. He knows the way. And when we follow what the prophet says to do, we will always be blessed. Our homes will be strengthened. Now, the Book of Mormon. This is a topic that I wish we could just spend the whole night talking about. I love the Book of Mormon. And I know that you will too. If you don't already love the Book of Mormon, we invite you to get a copy of the Book of Mormon and read it. Make it a part of your life, every day of your life, and you will see, as our brother earlier this evening testified of, there is a power in the Book of Mormon. I didn't know that's what he was going to talk about, but he testified of the power of the Book of Mormon. President Benson, who was a prophet many years ago, he said that the Book of Mormon teaches truth and it testifies of Jesus Christ, but he said, there is something more. He said, there is a power in the Book of Mormon that flows into our lives as soon as a person starts an honest study of it. An honest, prayerful study of the Book of Mormon. And I testify that that's true. When we go around to missionaries, I ask them, I say, what is the power that you've found in the Book of Mormon? I bet we could go around to all of these missionaries here and they could give you an answer to that. The power of conversion, the power of being strong to resist temptation, the power to overcome addictions, the power of unifying families, and on and on and on. I testify that you too will find that power as you study it regularly and with a prayer in your heart that you will know the truth of it. Now, the Book of Mormon is a testament of Jesus Christ, just like the Old Testament, the New Testament. The Book of Mormon is another testament of Jesus Christ. Joseph Smith has told us that
that the Book of Mormon, let's see, a man can get nearer to God by abiding by its precepts than by any other book. Now, I testify to you, and I know this in my own life, that you and I can draw closer to Jesus Christ through the Book of Mormon than in any other book. We love the Bible, and we do draw close to Jesus Christ through the Bible. But brothers and sisters, the Book of Mormon has Christ on every page, his name, his attributes, his teachings, his words, and most of all, his love. And I will end by just sharing a few scriptures in the Book of Mormon that I love because it shows me the love of Jesus Christ. In 2 Nephi, a short one, but a powerful one, says, "But behold, the Lord hath redeemed my soul, and I am encircled about eternally in the arms of his love." And then in Moroni, he teaches about charity, that charity is the pure love of Christ, and it endureth forever, and whoso is found possessed of it at the last day, it shall be well with him. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, pray unto the Father with all the energy of your heart, that ye may be filled with this love, which he hath bestowed upon all who are true followers of his Son, Jesus Christ, that ye may become the sons of God, that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is, that we may have this hope, that we may be purified even as he is pure. And once again, we invite you to make the Book of Mormon a part of your life every day. Come unto Christ through the Book of Mormon and receive the power that Christ would like to give you in your lives. So, another question. We've been blessed to know many good people here in West Africa. We've just been impressed by the goodness of the people that we've gotten to know here. Once in a while, we meet somebody that has had a harder life and that would say, "I've sinned. I don't think I can ever be forgiven of the things I've done." What would you say to them, Elder Kacher?
Well, before I answer that, can I say a word about the Book of Mormon? That'd be okay. I just want to be another witness, a third witness tonight after our earlier brother. Brothers and sisters, you will hear, now I'm going to talk to friends of the church for just a minute. You will hear that there is no other book except the Bible, that nobody can add any words to the Bible because of what's said in the Book of Revelations. I testify to you that that is not true. We can't shut off the heavens. God continues to speak to his people through living prophets when they're righteous people on the earth. In Revelations, that was referring to the Book of Revelations, not to the whole Bible. The Bible was compiled some 200 years after the life of Christ. So please, brothers and sisters, friends of the church, do what Sister Kacher has just said. I add my testimony to hers, that if you will read and study and pray to know that the Book of Mormon is true with a sincere heart, there is a promise contained in Moroni 10, that if you do so, God will speak to you and you will know of its truthfulness. Once you know of its truthfulness, you will know of the other things that we have talked about tonight, of God's plan of salvation for his children, of the restoration of the church on the earth. You will have a desire to follow Jesus Christ. Now back to this question about repentance that Sister Kacher, people feeling like they can't repent, that they're not good enough. This is a real issue. Before I say that, let me just say something about the wonderful people of West Africa. We love being here. There is no other place in the entire world where more people are turning to the restored gospel of Jesus Christ than here in West Africa. And we know it's because of the goodness of the people, because of your closeness to the Spirit, because of your love for Jesus Christ. But we need to change. We need to change every day, as President Nelson has said. He said repentance is a daily process, the process if we're ever going to be approached becoming more like our Heavenly Father. We have to rid ourselves of bad habits. We have to get past those things that hamper us from feeling close to him. When we were on our mission in Switzerland and France, the missionaries called me one day. They were teaching a young man named Guy. He had received the testimony of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He knew that it was true. He felt it was right. But as I talked to him, and as he explained to the missionaries, he said, I have done so many bad things in my life. There is no way that I can be forgiven of these things. Brothers and sisters, Guy was taught about the atonement of Jesus Christ, that the Savior had taken upon himself our sins and our afflictions, all of them, if we will come to him. He had a change of heart. He began to realize that God saw him differently than he saw himself. He accepted the gospel, was baptized, and became a faithful member of it. Another story in the Book of Mormon of Alma the Younger, the son of a prophet, who instead of following the example of his father, tried to destroy the church. An angel appeared to him, commanded him to repent. For 3 days, he entered a state of unconsciousness. During that period of time, the Lord changed his heart. He began to see the terrible things that he had done. He felt guilty, tortured by those thoughts. And then the teachings of his father came into his mind. The teachings of Jesus Christ and of his atonement. He held on to those words. And he said when he held on to those words, the pain that he had felt before was replaced by exquisite joy. And he was determined to change his life and turn it around. There is a price to pay, dear friends. There is a price to pay. It is not simple enough to say, I believe, and to put a few coins in the basket. The Lord requires much more. He requires a willing heart, a desire to change, and to follow him. We may fail, but as many times as we get up, he will be there to help us, to lead us on the path that he would have us follow. I know that that is true. How grateful I am. That is just one more reason why I believe in Jesus Christ. Sister Kacher, why don't you just share your feelings and any final thoughts you want to share?
Okay. I too would like to talk about the atonement of Jesus Christ. My husband talked about the blessings of the atonement in the lives of those of us that have sinned. And of course, we have all sinned and we all need to repent and we all need that atonement of Jesus Christ to help us in that process. But I'd like to talk about another aspect of the atonement of Jesus Christ. I'd like to talk about my mother. She was as much of a saint as anybody I've ever known, was loving and giving and serving and selfless all of her life. But she had a difficult life also. She had many trials, many difficulties that came into her life. But she continued serving and loving and blessing other people. So when she passed away at actually a very old age, I spent some time pondering her life. And as I pondered and prayed, I said to Heavenly Father, now as my mother steps into eternity, I pray that her memories of earth life will only be good memories and memories of happy times and joyful times. And I prayed that that the difficult times, times that she had been hurt, times that she had, the difficult times. I prayed that those things would be forgotten from her as she steps into eternity and that she would not remember those things in her life. And I received a very direct answer. And that answer was this, that in the lives of people like my mother, that is exactly what the atonement is about. That when a person has lived a Christ-like life, and of course nobody is perfect, we know that, but when somebody has lived a life that they have tried to draw close to Jesus Christ and done their best to be pure and good, that the atonement erases
the afflictions and the sorrows and the sadness and the hurt that we've felt in this life as we step into eternity. Jesus says, the Book of Mormon teaches us that Christ has died for our sins and to redeem us from death. But he also suffered pains and afflictions of every kind, and so that he would know how to succor us and how to bless us, and he would know exactly what we've experienced. And through his atonement, those things can be forgotten and done away with. Brothers and sisters, I'm grateful for this opportunity to bear witness to you of our Savior, Jesus Christ. I was grateful to hear of the title of this devotional tonight. Grateful to have the opportunity to testify of Jesus Christ in my life and testify that there have been many times in my life that I have not been given an assignment or had to do something that I knew I was not up. I was not strong enough or capable enough to accomplish what I was asked to do. But I have always known that I could call upon my Savior, Jesus Christ, and he would strengthen me. He would give me strength beyond my own. I testify that that is a real thing that we can call upon and ask for in our lives. I know that Heavenly Father lives and loves us and knows us, everyone. How that is possible is mind-boggling, but it is true. And I testify that the Holy Ghost will guide us through our lives. We'll have a member of the Godhead with us to guide us and lead us through our lives. I've already testified of the Book of Mormon and of the prophet and of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints that has given me guidance and a path in life. And I will finish by testifying of the temple. I am so grateful for the temple and for the endowment and the sealing. I'm grateful to be sealed to this good man and to our children, and to know that for eternity we can be together and that we can spend eternity trying to become more perfect and more like Jesus Christ and closer to our loving Heavenly Father. And I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. So, brothers and sisters, that's why we believe in Jesus Christ. That's why we believe. We are grateful for your faith and your belief. We invite you to choose wisely the decisions that you make each day. To remember the words of President Monson, that decisions determine destiny. To remember the words of President Nelson, though we can't control the circumstances of our lives, we can control the focus of our lives. To remember the words of the prophet Joseph Smith, that we are here to be happy, to have joy, and to find joy. I think about the question, how could the Savior have found joy when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, taking upon himself our sins and our afflictions, bleeding from every pore? But the answer is clear. He knew he was doing the Father's will. He knew he was breaking the bands of death for all of his Father's children. He knew he was bringing joy and happiness potentially into billions and billions of Heavenly Father's children. His focus outward, not on himself, not on his own suffering, allowed him to find joy. It is our hope and prayer that you will find joy in your lives by believing and following the example of Jesus Christ. As has been said, we invite you, those of you who are friends of the church, to listen to the missionaries, to read the Book of Mormon, to read the words of the holy prophets. And then, as you are touched by the Spirit of the Lord, as you feel a confirming influence of the Spirit in your heart and words flowing into your mind, in other words, a confirmation of the Holy Ghost that what you are doing is correct and right, we invite you to follow his example and to be baptized into the restored Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Begin that journey with us, brothers and sisters. Let's go forward with faith and belief in the Lord Jesus Christ with faith in every footstep is my prayer and our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Most gracious and everlasting Father, in the name of the children, we thank you for today, we thank you for all thank you for all the worship of thy kingdom here on earth and the Church of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the opportunity we have to be instructed by our Lord. We ask you to help us that we may be able to apply these principles. I mean,
Today, that thou grant us traveling mercies. We pray for constant companionship of the Holy Ghost, that we may do those things that are right in thy sight at all times. We pray for these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Our brothers and sisters, Elder and Sister Kacher will have to travel this evening, so they would have to. They would like to quickly rush out, and so they would love to have been visiting with you, but they can't, unfortunately. So if you would like to remain seated as they walk out, and then we can all then depart. Thank you so much for coming.